equipping effective advocates for family stability and love, both at home and in the public square. You can be better informed, more motivated, and more effective. Subscribe to our fact-filled newsletter, participate in our book clubs, attend a workshop, and of course, you're tuned into our podcasts. Dr. Jay is one of the speakers at the Asociación LAR Mexico conference in Monterrey, Mexico. Now in its 9th year, the theme this time around is the challenges of the family today. Dr. Jay gave 3 talks at the conference. This is the 3rd and final one on the gender ideology. Check out our podcast stream for the other 2.
Okay, he said I can start anytime I want, so I'm going to start because I'm ready. I'm ready. All right, this topic of the gender ideology, a number of you have come up to me privately and told me that you're so eager to hear about this because this is a subject that is on everybody's mind in a whole variety of different ways. And I'm going to tell you right now, I have way too many slides. I was working on this literally this morning because I'm troubled by this situation also. I also want to say that I've heard from people, many of the things that I've been talking about are going on in the United States. Did I lose my sound? There we go. Hello? There we go. All right. He taught me how to control the volume. That's dangerous. Okay. Many of the things that we've been talking about are unique to the United States, but they're not unique to the United States. They will be coming here. And I also just found out that the IFFD has a part that is involved with the United Nations and trying to deal with international law and the pressures that all the countries of the world are facing to adopt these kind of ideologies. So this is part of your organization also. And what I'd like to say to all of you, you are probably the most committed to the natural committed natural family of anybody. Right, in Mexico, wouldn't you say you guys are kind of at the top in terms of people who are committed to the natural family? So what I want to say to you is if you don't do something, no one will. If anything is going to happen in a positive direction, it's going to come from people in this room and the people that you influence. That's just a fact. I'm not trying to burden you or make you feel guilty. I think that is the truth of the matter, isn't it? Right? I mean, that's just the situation. I also am sure that you guys are all very busy. You all have jobs, vocations, lots of children and all of that. But some of you, they're in, within this room, there's over 100 people in this room, there is someone in this room who will come away from this weekend with a new vocation or with a new component to your existing vocation. That's what how I want you to think about what I'm talking about here. Because what you're going to see is way too much material. It's overwhelming. I've been, you know, agonizing over what to give you and what not to give you. If you have all signed up for the newsletter, you're going to receive all 75 slides. And so, therefore, the fact that I don't talk about all of them will be okay. Right? You'll have them as a reference point. So, even if you're already signed up, make sure you're signed up so that I can send you these slides. I also want you to know, some of you have already picked up these cards. We have only a few of them left. This is a little notification about an event that we're having in Lake Charles, Louisiana, about this very topic. It's by an author called Why I Don't Call Myself Gay. And I understand that there's an IFFD in Houston. Right? Houston is an easy 2-hour drive to us. So I want y'all to tell your friends in Texas that they must come. And of course, you must come also. If you want to, you can come. All right? All right. Now, in all of this material that I'm going to give you, there are 2 must-read articles, 2 things you must read. One of them is this big report by the New Atlantist called Sexuality and Gender. A lot of the material I'm going to take out today is coming from that article. But if you want to be informed about homosexuality and transgenderism, this is the place for you to start. Okay? And there's the URL on there so you can copy it and paste it. The other is just an article from a website called The Federalist, and the title of the article is Who Are the Rich White Men Institutionalizing Transgender Ideology? I'm not going to talk about it too much, but let me just give you the short version. It's the drug companies. Okay? People with very strong ties to the pharmaceutical industry like the idea of people being on hormones for a lifetime. Okay. So we'll just quickly review the sexual revolution, separating sex from babies, separating sex and babies from marriage, that's the divorce ideology, and then finally the gender ideology is to wipe out all differences between men and women, except those that we explicitly choose to bear. That's what we're going to talk about today, the gender ideology, the third point of the sexual revolution, and in many ways the oldest and most devastating part of the sexual revolution. Now, do these headlines upset you? Look at this first headline. Chilean abuse victim. Pope told me to accept being gay. God made me this way. Have you seen headlines like this? Or we only saw this in America? Okay, everybody saw this, okay? Then we have the gay community. LGBT activists praise Pope Francis' remarks that God made you gay. Okay, does this bother you? Okay, I'll take that as a yes. This is troubling to everyone. So I had to revise this whole talk because I really feel we need to deal with this. So the very first thing we're going to talk about is this question of, are people born gay? Because that was what was in the background of this comment, okay? It was the idea that people might be born gay. That's the first thing. We have no idea. I know you're upset about this, but give me a minute, okay? Just briefly, we're going to go through this. We're going to spend most of the presentation dealing with this problem. Are people born gay? Then we're going to look at the old school gender ideology of feminism, the new school gender ideology, which is transgenderism, and then finally, what can we do to help? All right, so the very first point is, we don't know. We actually do not know exactly what Pope Francis said. It was reported to us by a man who was a sex abuse survivor. So even if we knew what he said, we don't know what he meant. And for sure, we don't know what this guy, this poor guy, who's been abused by priests and had bishops covering up for him and so on, we don't know what he heard. Maybe he heard something he wanted to hear, something he needed to hear. We don't know, okay? We're never going to know that for sure, all right? And it's upsetting that this, you know, there's all these rumors and everything that can't be substantiated, but let's stick with what we do know, okay? Since we don't know this, we're going to just put it aside, and we're going to talk about what we do know. Now, implied in this comment that he supposedly made is a scientific claim. There's an implied scientific claim that you were born that way, all right? He didn't actually say that, but that's what he's thinking, that's what the activists are thinking, that's what everybody's thinking, you were born that way. Now, when I was a little girl and I learned that the Pope is infallible, this is what I was told. The Pope is infallible when he speaks ex cathedra on matters of faith and morals. We were told always as children, if he predicts the weather, he's not infallible. If he predicts who's going to win the World Series, he's not infallible, right? And if he makes a statement about science, he's not infallible. He can be mistaken. So what I'm going to show you, that the implied scientific claim is incorrect. And the reason he thinks it, and the reason a lot of people think it or don't know what to think, is because we've been flooded with a lot of false information designed to make us think that people were born gay. Okay? So that, I'm going to put a lot of emphasis on that question because I think it will help you unravel a lot of other points, right? Because this is like a core position or a key claim that they're making, and it affects a lot of other things. So let's jump right into it. Where did the born that way idea come from? I'm sorry to say, it came from the United States. Once again, I apologize for my country. Okay, here's where this came. It's very interesting. If you ask an American person who identifies as a homosexual, were you born that way, he'll probably say yes. If you ask a Frenchman or an Italian who identifies as gay, most likely they'll say, no, I wasn't born that way. What are you talking about? Right? They don't, not everybody thinks that. There's a very unique set of American circumstances that led to this claim being so important. And particularly what it is these guys had in their minds that they had a whole legal campaign to get rights for people who behave in a homosexual manner. In the United States, you probably know we have terrible race problems. Okay, the relations between blacks and whites in the United States is very complicated, very difficult. And one of the things we've developed over the years is a whole body of law called anti-discrimination law that is meant to protect black people from unlawful, unjust discrimination. So we have a well-developed body of law around that line. So what the sexual revolutionary activists thought to themselves, if we can make people think that being gay is somehow like being black, then all that body of law will apply. And that is exactly what they set out to do. I will tell you two things about that. One is American black people despise it. It makes them very angry because they don't think being gay is like being black. They don't think that. Most American black people are quite religious, actually. They're good Christian people. They're not Catholic, but they're good evangelical, Bible-believing Christians, and they tend to be in favor of man-woman marriage. They don't approve of homosexual practice, and they certainly don't approve of homosexual marriage. And taking their civil rights achievements, their civil rights law, and applying it to same-sex practice, same-sex sexual activity, it makes them very mad. You know, so just so you know, that's just a little quirk about American life. The second thing I want you to know about this is that this claim was part of the Supreme Court case, Obergefell versus Hodges, you probably heard of that case, the Supreme Court that legalized, required genderless gay marriage throughout the United States. The idea, this born that way, the court accepted this born that way idea, they accepted it. However, if you look at the court documents and you look at the expert witnesses that they called for this case, the Proposition 8 case, which I was involved in, if you look at the expert witnesses and the expert testimony that they had, they did not bring a single witness to testify that people are born gay. They had not one expert to say under oath, that people are born that way or that there's a gay gene or anything like that. They implied it, they suggested it, everybody acted as if it was true, but they didn't prove it. And you can look at those documents yourself if you have a mind to. All right, so that's one reason, I believe that is the big reason why born that way has become such an important part of the thought process around all of these issues. There's a second reason. And that is, has to do with this man who was abused by a priest. It has to do with many people who are propositioned sexually by a man, right? We have an expression called a pickup line. Do you know what I mean when I use this line? A pickup line? So you're in a bar. You're a guy, you're in a bar. You know, and you're trying to pick up a date, right? You're trying to pick her up. You have little lines that you say to make her come along with it. So think about this. You were born that way. I'm your destiny. Right? Okay. Think about how ugly that is. If an older person can make a younger person believe that, how vulnerable that person really is. And I am quite convinced that this operates as a pickup line for some people. And that may be what Juan Carlos Cruz heard from his predators when he was a young boy. He may have heard that. So what did he think? We don't know. We don't know what he was thinking. But I want you to have that in your mind. Think about this experience that some of these people may have had. So these are some of the contested questions that we're going to go over. All right. What does it even mean to be gay? What does the word gay even mean? Second, what causes some people to experience same-sex attraction as a prominent and semi-permanent part of their personality? And third, do people change their patterns of attractions, behaviors, or commitments and identifications, okay? So what does gay mean? What is the cause of gay? And do people change their self-identification, behavior, or attraction? So let's jump right into it. What does gay mean? Well, what does it mean scientifically? People have been trying, you know, this might be a little much. This is a lot of detail, but I hope it will be helpful to you. It's a little bit nerdy also, so I apologize for that. But, okay, so suppose you're a science person, a social science person, and you want to measure how many gay people there are. What do you ask? What are the questions you ask? Well, it turns out, since at least 1994, when people have been asking this in a systematic way, they'll ask, are you attracted to people of the same sex? That's one thing it might mean. Or you could say, have you ever had sex with a person of the same sex? Or you could ask, do you identify yourself as gay or lesbian? So there are three conceptually distinct components here of what it could mean. If you want to know gay, what does that mean? It could be attraction, it could be the sexual activity itself, and it could be self-identification. So back in the day, when this big University of Chicago study was done in 1994, are you attracted to people of the same sex? They came out with these numbers. Men, 6.2%, women, 4.4% said, yes, I'm attracted to people of the same sex. Have you ever had sex with a person of the same sex at any time since puberty? Okay, so since puberty, what percentage of people have ever had sex, had a single same-sex partner? Okay, men, 9.1% report at least one partner, same-sex partner, and women at 4.3% report at least one same-sex partner. Now, if you ask them how many sex partners, what about in the last year, what about in the last 6 months, you get a different number, right? You get a different number. So what does it mean? You can see it's not clear exactly what. And then finally, ask people, do you identify yourself as gay or lesbian? 2.8% of men say, yes, I identify as gay. 1.4% of women said, yes, I identify as lesbian. This is in 1994, mind you, okay? But what the point of here is, you can see it's not the same thing, right? It's not the same thing. Now, let me put this idea in your mind. Do we have anybody here who's a medical doctor? Do we have any medical people? Okay, sometimes in a room like this there'll be a few doctors. But anyway, if you're a medical doctor and you want to study disease, okay, you care about the activity. You don't really care that much about the other things. You're not interested in their fantasies. You want to know, did you have sex with a person of the same sex, and how often and how recently? So in that business, they actually have a little acronym. It says MSM. It means men having sex with men. They're not saying this is a gay person, because they don't care if you're gay. They care, did you do the deed? Right? That's what we care. That's what we're trying to measure for that purpose. Not the same thing at all as, do you subscribe to a gay publication? You know, they're not interested in that, right? So there's a reference to it. Okay, gay could also mean, from the individual, another perspective is, have you had sex exclusively with same-sex partners since puberty? Now, if you look at that, that's not very many people at all. 0.6% of men report that they have never had sex with anything but another man, and 0.2% of women report that they've never had sex with anybody except other women. So again, a very different concept depending on what you're looking for, what you're trying to measure. And here's the reference for you. One important scholar in this area, Dr. Lisa Diamond, who identifies herself as a lesbian, by the way, okay, she says there is currently no scientific or popular consensus on the exact constellation of experiences that definitively qualify an individual as lesbian, gay, or bisexual. True confession, somebody who watched the litigation very closely, watched things go through the courts, don't you think this is a fact that should have been brought to the attention of the court? You're trying to create a protected class that you can't even define. That's what happens. That's what is happening in the United States, okay? And our legal team, I will tell you, the legal team that fought for traditional marriage did a lousy job, because this should have been right at the center of their arguments. We don't even know what we're talking about. I don't know why they didn't bring this up, but they didn't, okay? So anyway, there you are. What does it mean to be gay? We don't really know. So what might an individual person think, okay? So now you're not a science guy, you're just a guy, you're just a gal. And you're asking yourself, am I gay? Well, what might a person mean when they say they're gay? They might mean that they experience same-sex attraction, but they've never had any sexual activity, they're living a chaste life, and that's really important to them. Sometimes people like that will call themselves gay. They might be trying it as a lifestyle. So this is a big thing on college campuses in the United States. It's called LUG, they call themselves LUGs, lesbian until graduation. They're just messing around, okay? But they like the identity, they like something about the identity, all right? I'm sorry to shock you guys. You guys are so innocent. But we're adults and we got to deal with this, okay? But this is a thing. This is a real thing, okay? And so if that's what they mean, that's something quite different from born that way. Wouldn't you say? It's quite different, all right? I used to live that way. I'm now not only not living that way, I'm married to an opposite sex partner. There are actually quite a few of those people out there that we call, sometimes they're called ex-gay, okay? Sometimes people are gay in a situation, what we call situational gayness. They're on board a ship, and there's back in the day when there's only men. They're in prison. They're in a boarding school, which may be all the same thing. I don't know. But they're in a situation. They are gay for a season, basically, because that's men, I guess. There could be. I wouldn't know. You guys, I have a confession to make. I've been a woman my whole life, okay? Except when I was a little girl, okay? All right. There are people who did it a few times, who did the act a few times, didn't like it, got away from it. They did it and continue to do it, but they're not really satisfied with it, but they might call themselves gay. That might be where all their friends are and where all their associations are. They did it, they do it, they don't like it, they've tried to stop, but they can't stop. That may be more, we don't know how common that may be, but it's probably pretty common because there's a lot of compulsive same-sex behavior. They're not having sex, but they may still struggle with related issues having to do with their gender identity, having to do with just how they perceive themselves as male and female. Or it could be that when somebody says I'm gay, they mean they're completely committed to the entire gay agenda. It could mean any of those things, right? So, and we're not really measuring or tracking any of that. So just have all of that ambiguity in your mind. That's the main point. So now we're going to ask, what causes some people, to experience same-sex attraction as a prominent part of their personality? So just go in mind here, keep in mind, we don't even really know what we're talking about, all right? So just say someone's born gay, or people are born that way, we don't even know which one of those things we're talking about, right? All right, so what are the causes? What might be some of the causes? All right, so some possible causes. This is all theoretical now. What could some of the causes be? It might be genetic. It might be hormonal. It might be developmental. Maybe something went wrong in the development, in the child's developmental process. Or there could be social and cultural influences. For example, I'm pretty sure that the girls at Smith College who call themselves SLUGs, Smith Lesbians Until Graduation, I'm pretty sure that's cultural and social, right? When you think that's probably what that's about, it's probably have nothing to do with any of these other issues, right? All right, so let's go through them. Let's think this through a little bit, okay? Because every time somebody goes, bang, born that way, okay? They're trying to stop you from thinking through all the other stuff, right? That's a way of stopping thought. We want to keep the thought process going and open. And you want to have that in your mind, by the way, when you're talking with people, okay? All right. Are there genetic causes? Okay, there is no gay gene, people. The whole human genome has been mapped. There's no gay gene. That doesn't exist. There have been studies done of twins. identical twins, fraternal twins. Okay? If it was purely genetic, you would expect a very high concordance between identical twins, right? That if one twin is gay, the other twin should be gay also. And those studies do not show that. And in the first article that I told you that you must read by from the New Atlantis, they go through all those studies in some detail. The best you can say is that it is inconclusive. That's the best you can say. Some of the studies flat out say, no, it can't be. Really, it should, no. And some of the studies are like, maybe, right? But inconclusive. And there's certainly no gay gene. Now, hormonal causes. I'm going to pause on this for a moment. The theory about hormonal causes is that sometimes in utero, a child may be flooded with an inappropriate amount of hormones, okay, that there could be some imbalance in the hormones in utero that changes the development of the brain in some way. So this is a theory. Now, if you look at the studies of that subject, it turns out those two are all inconclusive, with one very interesting exception that I'm going to mention to you. I don't expect you to remember it, but I want you to see it because it's very unlikely. There is one condition called congenital adrenal hyperplasia. Okay, in girls, this is one of the intersex conditions. In girls, basically, if they've got too much male hormone, their genitalia may be formed not completely female and looking a little bit like male, all right, and not a full-on male genitalia, but looking more like that, okay? And so this is a serious medical condition, right? It's an intersex condition, a serious medical condition. In that case, those girls are more likely to identify as something other than exclusively heterosexual. They might call themselves lesbians, they might call themselves bisexual. But that's a very serious medical condition that has other consequences that you can also measure and observe. All right? But the theory that gay is caused in utero by an imbalance of hormones, there is basically no evidence for that claim. Now, developmental causes. Something happened developmentally to steer the child's pattern of attractions away from heterosexual exclusive attractions. So I put this up here because it used to be that clinicians, therapists, people who would see people in their office all the time, they had a theory about the development of same-sex attraction. Their theory had to do with, and this was a theory that was exclusively for boys, by the way, I want you to notice this, that a little boy needs to separate from his mother and become attached to the world of men in some way. And the proper relationship between the mother and the father and between the mother and the father and the child should be under correct conditions, supporting the child's move away from mommy and into the world of manhood, okay? So if the mother is domineering and overbearing and doesn't allow him to develop, that can interfere with that process. If the father is distant or absent or abusive, the child may not want to be part of that world and may develop a kind of aversion to manliness and be more attracted to something feminine, okay? So this is a theory that clinicians came up with. They were the ones dealing with people up close, right? They were actually talking to people and watching their mom and dad and how their parents behaved and, you know, all of those kind of things. And this is the theory that they had, and this was the dominant theory for quite a while. Now, you can't even say this in the United States. You can barely say this because this is considered homophobic. It's considered anti-gay because they want you to believe that there's nothing abnormal about a gay orientation. Okay, there's nothing. It's not sick. It's not a problem. It's been removed from the list of mental illnesses. So there's no reason to think there's a developmental cause or a developmental problem. Okay. So, however, as far as I can tell, this theory has never actually been disproven. It's just been kind of shouted down. All right. The other thing I want to point out to you is that this is a theory exclusively having to do with boys. And I just want to point out in general, nobody who's doing serious work in this area believes that they're going to come up with one theory that accounts for same-sex attraction in boys and same-sex attraction in girls. This theory, of course, is all about boys, right? But even the guys who are studying hormones and the people who are studying brains and, you know, all that stuff, they don't think they're going to come up with one theory that explains everything. So that, too, is worth noting, because that suggests that there's something unique about male and female that is over and beyond whether you're born that way, right? The born that way, even if it's true, is going to look different for boys than for girls, right? All right. All right, now another developmental cause, another candidate for a developmental cause of same-sex attraction is childhood abuse, particularly sexual abuse. Now, this table that I've put up here is from one study. There are a variety of studies of this question. There is evidence to suggest that people who identify as gay, lesbian, and especially bisexual are more likely than average to have experienced some form of abuse as children. So whether they were sexually abused and then their pattern of eroticism becomes focused on the person who abused them, since that was maybe the first thing, their first sexual experience was like that, it distorts what they want, what they feel, that's possible. Now, the reason I say this is contested is because some people speculate that it's not the abuse itself that did it, but that the child was already gay, and people had a tendency to reach out to that person, or maybe to be unkind to that person, or something like that. In other words, that it's not that the abuse causes gayness, but that gayness is simply correlated with the experience of abuse. And that has not been completely sorted out scientifically, I will just tell you. That's not completely sorted out. But the thing that's important about this is that whatever caused one thing or the other, if you're addressing a person or dealing with a person, interacting with a person who has a strong orientation or a strong identification with gay, lesbian, or bisexual, they might have this in their background, and they might not feel like talking about it right away, right? So you want to, if you can, open yourself and leave some space in the conversation so that they can bring it up if they want to. I know from a number of people who do have a lot of interaction with same-sex attracted persons that they want to talk about it. And gay affirming therapy quite often won't let them talk about it, right? There's a lot of times not room for that conversation if the main purpose of the therapy is to affirm your gay identity. You know, then people don't necessarily want to go there. So I've just put that out there for you. Try to make room in the conversation for it. All right. Social and cultural influences on same-sex attraction. Now, this is very interesting. Are there things in the environment that might cause you to be more involved in same-sex sexual activity or self-identification in that way? Well, it turns out we've known since 1994, these first two things, that people who live in urban areas are more likely to show up as gay on any of the measures they had. Okay, remember, this was the study that had three different ways of measuring. Do you count as gay? Do you count as lesbian? Okay, they had three different, any of those measures, it turned out if you lived in an urban area, you were more likely to identify as gay. If you had higher education, you were more likely to identify as gay or lesbian. In fact, women who were college educated were 9 times more likely to identify themselves as lesbian. Okay, so that's probably not a genetic theory. There's something else going on there, right? More recently, there's evidence that parental separation or divorce is a risk factor, right? So in other words, if your parents were separated or divorced, there's a higher chance that you will identify as something other than exclusively heterosexual. All right. We don't know exactly why or what the pattern of that is, but you can see it in some of the charts that as you move away from mom and dad being married to each other and go to all those other forms of family breakdown that we talked about, including having same-sex parents, right? As you move along there, what you'll find is a higher probability of the person identifying themselves as something other than exclusively heterosexual. So there, again, it suggests something developmental is going on that's being tracked this way. So now, the American Psychological, I want to wrap up this part of the talk this way. The American Psychological Association is not a Humana Vitae Catholic group, right? Okay, the American Psychological Association is 100% in favor of the whole sexual revolutionary agenda. In fact, you could say that they were part of the honor guard of it, right? They're guarding certain ideas. However, they came out with this statement, and I'm going to read it to you, and I've tried to emphasize certain words. There is no consensus among scientists about the exact reasons that an individual develops a heterosexual, bisexual, gay, or lesbian orientation. Although much research has examined the possible genetic, hormonal, developmental, social, and cultural influences on sexual orientation, no findings have emerged that permit scientists to conclude that sexual orientation is determined by any particular factor or factors. Many think that nature and nurture both play complex roles. Most people experience little or no sense of choice about their sexual orientation. In other words, there's no scientific basis for the born that way belief. None. No scientific basis for it at all. And even if you knew the cause for one person, it might not be the same cause for someone else, right? Right? Because it's a complex, that's what it means to have a complex of factors, right? I think it's more humane to take the position that it's a complex of factors, not just because it's true, but also it's more humane to the person who happens to be in front of you, that you have room for them to be who they are, to have had their experience, rather than assume they are gay, therefore they are a symbol of our ideology, they must have been born that way. Right, and you're closed off to hearing anything different from them about their own life. That's what the sexual revolution does to people. That's what it did to women, what it does to children of divorce, that's just what it does to people. All right, so, and they're just chugging along, doing it to another group of people. All right, so, in that article that I have by two psychiatrists, the New Atlantis article, he poses this image, okay? You got a young guy, maybe he's 16. This is a hypothetical, all right? This is a guy, maybe 16 years old. He's having these fantasies. He sees a guy who's really attractive to him in some way. And he's thinking about it, and he's wondering, and they're at a party, and they do something. And he has a whole lot of feelings about it. And he asks himself, does this mean I'm gay? Dr. McHugh says, current research from the sciences suggests that this question makes no sense. For him to ask himself, does this mean I'm gay because I did that? This question is not properly framed. It doesn't mean anything. As far as science can tell us, there's nothing there for the young man to discover. There's no fact of nature to be found within himself, to uncover or be unburied within himself. I believe this is a more accurate picture of what is happening to young people. Okay? So I want you to have that in your mind. And you'll see, when you read the article, you'll see everything that he has to say. So the understanding of sexual orientation is an innate, biologically fixed property of human beings. The idea that people are born that way is not supported by scientific evidence. This is the same doctors, Dr. Mayer and McHugh. All right, finally, do people change their patterns of attractions, behaviors, or commitments? Notice I don't say, can they? Just do they? All right. Sexual orientation may be quite fluid over the life course for some people. Here's a study from that interviewed adolescents in 1994, and then again three other times, the last time being in 2007. the men that were boys, same-sex attracted or bisexually attracted in 1994. By 2007, 80% of them identified themselves as exclusively heterosexual. So over that course of time, between 1994 and 2007, 80% of them no longer identified as gay or bisexual. We don't know why. We don't know. Maybe they were never gay in the first place. Maybe they tried something and changed their mind. Maybe they were and they shifted. We don't know why, okay? This is why I don't ask, can people change? Let's just ask, first of all, do they change? And the answer is yes, sometimes they do. We don't know why or how, but sometimes they do, okay? And this is evidence towards this fact. And there's other evidence comparable. So this book here by Daniel Mattson, Why I Don't Call Myself Gay, it's a very important book. He's the author of that book. Dan Mattson is going to be our speaker at our dinner in Lake Charles in a few weeks, okay? But the point is, identification, how you identify yourself, is for sure a decision, right? You have a choice about what to call yourself. You have a choice about how to behave. Those are choices. So your feelings, you may have very strong feelings of aversion to people of the opposite sex. You may have very strong feelings of attraction to people of the same sex. Those feelings, okay, maybe you can't control the feelings. Maybe that's true. But you can control what you call yourself. You can control how you behave, what you do about that. And that's a lot of the theme of Dan's book. He's trying to explain to young people, you know, don't put this label on yourself, right? Don't put this label on yourself because it's limiting. Your real label is child of God. That's your ultimate identity. All right, all these references for you. All right, so for now, I'm done talking about born that way. Okay, we're going to put that aside for a minute, and I'm going to quickly go through some of the other topics that we have here, and then I'm going to open it for questions, and we can go into more detail. I'm going to show you what's on these slides, and then we can go into more detail about whatever topic you guys would like to go into, okay? And I don't insist, don't write down your questions. When the time comes, just, you know, we'll deal with it. Okay, all right, so gender ideology, old school, old-fashioned feminism. What is the gender ideology? Well, back in the day when I first learned about it, we were told men and women are the same. Men and women are identical, except women are better. Right? Right? That's feminism. That's feminism. Women loved it because it appealed to our ego. Right? This is like a near occasion of sin for all of us, you know? We're so special, you know? Okay. Therefore, but here's the therefore. Therefore, wiping out all differences between men and women is absolutely an imperative. We must wipe out all those differences because men and women, they're all fake. There aren't really any differences between men and women. But you see, the contradiction was there from the beginning, right? But this idea that you're going to wipe out all differences of things that are actually the same, that empowers the people who are in charge of doing that, right? So, examples of this view of the gender ideology, I don't know how crazy it is here. My sense is that Latin people are not quite as crazy as Anglos in this matter. That there's more appreciation of male and female, you know. But anyway, we have a law called Title IX of the Civil Rights Act that required equality in sports programs so that colleges were supposed to have the same number of sports for men as for women and the same number of participants for men and for women, even if the girls weren't interested. Right? Boys are more interested. Girls were less interested. So while this was happening, what they were doing is the federal government was going around to universities and colleges, shutting down men's sports programs, ending wrestling programs. Wrestling and track, well, not track so much because girls could do that, but wrestling programs was generally on the chopping block. They turned dance into a sport. Right, because girls would be interested in that, and they could count that towards their quota. But this idea that it was unlawful discrimination if you had more boys participating in sports than girls, that was federal law. All right? We changed the physical fitness requirements for law enforcement and military so that women could pass them. All right? That's kind of interesting that we did that. Okay. All right. I have several slides about the differences between men and women that are surely biological, that surely cannot be entirely culturally conditioned. So in utero, more little boys are conceived than girls, about 120 to 100 more boys are conceived. The reason being that little boys are more likely to have stillbirths and miscarriage. This is nature's way of coming up with a sex ratio at birth that's kind of balanced, right? But in utero, little boys are more likely to have brain damage, cerebral palsy, congenital deformities. They're more likely to be premature birth, okay? That is not culturally conditioned. You think? What do you think? Okay, that's nature. There's something going on that's different with boys versus girls. Once they're born, do you have this term male privilege? Do people talk about that here?
No.
Good. If you hear it, stomp it out, okay? Because it's a very insidious thing that we have in the United States. Men are naturally privileged just by being men. That's the idea. Okay. So I put up here some examples of male privilege, things men are more likely to have happen to them after they're born. They're more likely to have autism, be clumsy, have Tourette's syndrome, have reading delays, be hyperactive, stammering, conduct and oppositional disorders, being disruptive in school. That is more male privilege. Okay. Boys are more likely to have all that happen. It's not that their moms are making them autistic or something. How would that possibly be anything but biology? Right? One author says boys are developmentally delayed at birth compared to girls. And she concludes, therefore, boys are more in need of a sensitive caregiver to help them navigate the world. Okay? So they need their mommies, little boys. And we know that because boys are more vulnerable in situations where there are stress in their environment. So when you're studying child development, what you'll see is if the kids have too much daycare, if their mommies are depressed, if they have a mother-only home, they have no father in the home, the little boys are more likely to suffer bad consequences from that. They need us. Okay, our little boys need us. Can't be socially constructed. Okay, now, the last point I want to make about old school feminism and the gender ideology, okay? The whole movement towards transgenderism is part of the gender ideology, as I'm going to explain in a minute. But this did not just sneak up on us the day before yesterday. It kind of looks like it. It kind of looks like, you know, with all this push to identify people as transgender and everything, but they have been working on degendering everybody for a long time. When I was a little girl, it was okay for me to say, I want to be a mommy when I grow up. By the time I was in college, it was not okay for me to say that. Oh, you want to be a doctor or a lawyer or a PhD and a mommy too, right? That's what we were all told. So that business of having us all behave like men in skirts, maybe, but now the men are wearing skirts, whatever. That's been going on a long time. That's the thing I want to point out here. So now, the new school gender ideology, transgenderism. I'm going to show you how these are related. It used to be, at least in the US, that we were banning certain things because they were unlawful sex discrimination. So we ban father-daughter dances because, well, why would you have a father-daughter dance? Why not a parent-child dance? I mean, because you think that there's something special about the relationship between the father and the daughter that it's going to protect her and be good for her. But no, we don't allow that, right? We don't allow that. So that is a kind of saying gender doesn't matter. The sex of the body doesn't matter. We can't allow it to matter. We can't allow you to pretend that it matters. It doesn't matter. But now we have gender-neutral bathrooms, okay? So anybody can use any bathroom they want, okay? That's the new version of it. So now we're trying to wipe out all the differences between men and women except those that the individual specifically chooses to embrace. That's where we are now with the gender ideology. So we have Bruce Jenner. Okay, you guys recognize Bruce Jenner. You know this whole thing. Okay, so this is, just for those of you who maybe don't know, this is the 1976 Olympic decathlon winner, who was really a woman all along. We just didn't know that he was a woman. She was a woman. Okay, he's decided that he's a she. All right, so what I want you to notice about this image, and most of the images that you now see of Bruce Jenner, is the stereotypical image of femininity. All right, so before we weren't allowed to have any stereotypes about what it means to be male and female. Now we've got a man dressing in the most extreme stereotype of femininity, and that's proof that he's really a woman, okay? I don't dress like that. Right? Y'all in this room, you don't dress like that, right? We don't dress like that, right? So here we are, some man telling us what it means to be a woman. I don't like it, and I think we shouldn't accept that, okay? Now, here's the next one. This is Bruce, and he literally said this, the hardest part about being a woman is figuring out what to wear. Really, Bruce? I mean, really? Okay, now, a lot of people criticized him for saying this, which was good that they criticized him, but that's the way his mind is working, right? He's attracted to a certain very stereotypical image of what it means to be female. Now, there are contradictory visions at work here. One is showing up now in sports, and perhaps, I'm sure you've heard about this because the International Olympic Committee is taking on the idea that people should be able to compete in the sport for the gender with which they identify. So a man who thinks he's a woman can compete in a woman's event. And we have here a couple of examples of that. This boy, who's transgender, thinks he's a girl. He won 2 state championships in girls' track. Okay? This guy, who thinks he's a woman, is a professional boxer, and basically seriously injured his female opponent in a cage match. Okay? So it's basically people paying to watch a man batter a woman. Right? That's what this amounted to. And it's the same Title IX, this is the thing, the same law that had the federal government going around wiping out men's wrestling programs because we must have girls in sports. Now we're using that same law to say it's your gender identity, not your body, that matters, and which will wipe out all women's sports. There will be no way women can compete against men in track or weightlifting or boxing or any of those sports. Okay? So this tells us that the point was never getting women into sports. Women in sports, that was never the issue. That was never the point. That was never what they were looking for. What they were looking for was power. Okay? And that has morphed from one step to the next. All right. Okay, this lady, just briefly, this is Sheila Jeffries. She's a radical feminist, lesbian feminist, who is totally against the transgender agenda. Okay, and the transgender people despise her and everybody who's like her, and they made up a mean name for them, trans exclusionary radical feminists, TERFs. Okay, and they show up at her speeches and shout her down and everything else. But think about from the perspective of the radical lesbian feminist. I know you don't do this every day, but just enter into this mindset. They've been fighting for years for safe spaces for women. And now here we have a bunch of guys coming in and saying, we want to be part of your lesbian music festival. We want to enter your female-only bathroom, you know? And they're like, no, we don't want that. So now there are actually alliances being built within the United States between very conservative people and this type of feminist. It's very interesting. But it's because the ideology is starting to unravel. The contradictions are just are too much. So this is a related contradiction. A person who experiences same-sex attraction is supposed to be born that way. But a person who experiences gender dysphoria, meaning they don't like whether they're a boy or a girl, they're not born that way. We got to do everything possible to help them change from having a girl body to having a boy body. We have to do everything possible. They're not born that. You're not born male or female. You're born straight or gay. That's what's going on here. But what these things have in common is that the human body is unimportant. See, both of these theories, both of these things are saying the human body is unimportant. We can transcend it either through social reconstruction or through individual reconstruction. You can reconstruct your body with some combination of law and technology, and you can really, Bruce Jenner can really be have everyone accept him as a woman. So I consider that a form of Gnosticism. For those of you who know your church history, this is the oldest, one of the very oldest of heresies. The assault on that. So, now, briefly, all right, translator, you're on. Read that whole list. No. The point of this list, I want to just help you draw a distinction between the transgender and the intersex. The intersex is a medical condition, a diagnosable medical condition. Do I have that, a slide that says that? Yeah. There's a whole variety of conditions where there may be some kind of hormonal difference, or there may be some kind of differences with the secondary sex characteristics, or something in the genes themselves. There are a variety of these issues. The point about them is that there's a bunch of them. They're medically diagnosable. Typically, you can see them at birth. Some are actually life-threatening, like the one that I mentioned earlier, where the girls have the hyperplasia. Some of those are very serious medically and can kill you. And people need to be watching those. They need to be monitoring that. And typically, when a child is born with some kind of condition like that, the parents are on top of it and trying to have the doctors work with them and so on and so forth. They need the supervision of their parents. They need the involvement of their parents. This is completely different from gender dysphoria, okay? Gender dysphoria is a felt sense that you're in the wrong body, okay? And it describes a psychological condition in which they experience an incongruence between their experienced gender and the gender associated with their biological sex. It's a psychological condition. And legally, when the Obama administration put out guidelines for how to treat transgender students, there was no requirement of any medical diagnosis. So it was completely different from the intersex in that respect, okay? The transgender phenomenon is a psychological self-identification that may have no medical basis whatsoever, and legally doesn't need to have any medical basis. You do not and are not allowed to ask the person, you know, show me a diagnosis. So what that means, and so we talked about this one in the Obama administration. I don't want to go into this too much, but the law that they were coming down with was something that was saying basically you don't need to be diagnosed. If you show up at school and say, I'm a boy today, the school not only had to honor that and let you use the boys' restroom or the girls' restroom, they weren't allowed to tell the parents. Think about that. They were not allowed to tell the parents. All right, so in general, we can say intersex is a medical category. Gender dysphoria is a psychological category. And transgenderism is a political category. It is a political category. Okay? Yeah, go ahead. I'm going to send, it won't be long before you'll have a whole series of slides, but yes, go ahead, take a few photos. All right. So who benefits from this ideology? I would say the state benefits from it by separating children from their parents and inflicting penalties on people that don't use the right pronoun. Okay. Briefly, I'm going to talk to you about the fact that the people who do these surgeries do not screen people appropriately. Somebody comes in, there are all sorts of things they should be screening them for. But this person was born a woman, wanted to be a man, had surgery, considered the surgery to have been botched. She then committed suicide. She was euthanized under Belgian law. Okay, it's just going from bad to worse with this person. Then you come to find out that her mother always wanted a boy. Now, why didn't somebody look at that a little bit before we did all kinds of other stuff? This is a guy named Walt Heyer, who also had transgender surgery performed on him. He lived as a woman. This is him. This is him as a little boy, as a young boy. This is him living for the 10 or 12 years that he lived as a woman. This is him today, okay? So he transitioned and detransitioned, okay? And he has a website to help people deal with that, because in his case, he knows for sure he had some psychological disorders that were never diagnosed, right? He had a dissociative disorder. He had some child abuse issues and stuff like that. So he's got a website that's about sex change regret, and you can find that also. So this isn't, again, something that you, you know, kind of want to have in your toolkit to know that there are. Have you ever heard of any of these people? No, all we hear is Bruce Jenner's happy. That, you know, right? We don't hear about the people who regret it or the people who had other problems and so on and so forth. Okay. All right. So what can we do to help? I think I'm gay. Mom, I think I'm gay. Okay. Here's what you do. First of all, don't freak out. Don't panic. Okay. I think I'm gay. What you do is you say, what do you mean? What does that mean to you? Because think about all those different things that we had there at the beginning of the talk, okay? What? Find out what they mean when they say that. And listen, and then figure out what to do or not do. It may be you don't have to do anything, right? Right? But that the very first thing you've got to do is ask them, what do you mean? All right? So that's very important. I have a couple of people I want to tell you about, a couple websites I want to tell you about. Now, again, we're all adults in this room. Some of the material I'm about to tell you about, I don't give to teenagers or tell them about it. But you as adults need to know this is out there, all right? This is my friend Robert Oscar Lopez, and we are great pals. You can find us together on the website, on the web, all over the place, because we've been in many fights together. Bobby Lopez was raised by his mother and her lesbian partner. And when the whole debate over children, the children are fine, the children of gay parents, they're all fine, it's all going to be fine, Bobby kind of raised his hand and said, hello, no, it was not great, let me explain, you know, kind of thing. So he was a very outspoken critic, has written a lot about it, spoken a lot about it. He was attacked by the gay lobby, and I'm not kidding when I say attacked. This is one kind of person they cannot allow to be real, okay? The person who says, I lived through it, and your story is wrong. Here's another part of the story, okay? They had to attack him because he said, it's not great for the children. It was awful for me to lose contact with my father. My development as a man was stunted. I got involved in the gay lifestyle and gay activity because that's what was in front of me. I didn't like it. It took me a long time to get out of it. Well, they just went after him. They attacked him. I was kind of in the middle of it, one of the attacks. And he lost his job. He was a professor of English at one of the Cal State schools. He's fluent in like five languages, and he lost his job. He now teaches at a Baptist seminary is where he teaches now. But he's got on his website, he's got tips for men who are gay, who want to leave the gay lifestyle. He's got like a whole set of articles about what to do and how to do it and so on and so forth. This is not something everybody needs, but you should know it's out there, okay? He's talking to some people, and the people who want it really want it, right? They really are desperate to hear what he has to say. So this is Bobby's description of himself. Robert Oscar Lopez has been described as bisexual, gay, ex-gay, a former homosexual, a self-hating bigot, an immoral man, a hater, a scumbag, a raging misogynist, and many other things. Currently, he is straight and chaste. He has been with his wife for 19 years and has two children. He firmly supports chastity and opposes fornication and adultery, though he has been a sinner and has had to repent of many sins of the flesh. Once upon a time, he was gay. Okay, so this man has something to say to certain people. Certain people you may encounter may benefit from what he has to say. This is another guy, Joseph Sciambra. His website is called josephsciambra.com. .com? Yeah. He was a gay porn star. Okay, so he was deeply embedded in the gay lifestyle. He talks, and he is now Catholic. He always was Catholic. He attributes his conversion to his father's unending prayer for him. And he came back to the faith, living a chaste life. Before his father died, he was able to reconcile with his father and so on. So that is a very beautiful thing. Well, what he talks about is the raw reality of gay life, just the physicality of it, which most people don't even want to think about, but the health hazards that are associated with that. Okay? So, again, don't send your kids to this, but if you've got somebody who's dealing with it, there's a reality there that you will never see on the TV sitcoms, right? They're never going to talk to you about what's really involved, what it does to your body, what it feels like 10 years later. Okay? You're never going to hear that. And you may have people who do need to know that. So, you know, I'm sorry to shock you with this stuff, but you guys, we can't flinch over this stuff. All right. So, finally, how can we be helpful? This is my friend Dan Mattson. Picture Dan, who wrote the book, Why I Don't Call Myself Gay. In general, without going to Joseph Sciambra, without going to Bobby Lopez, in general, what you want to do, I think, is to support young people in their sense of themselves as male and female. Support them, okay? And give them the space to talk about whatever's going on with them, particularly if you have reason to think there is some trauma or sexual abuse going on, okay? You got to steel yourself, you know, to deal with whatever maybe has to be dealt with. And then I always tell this to young people when I'm talking to college students, be friends with them. Don't exclude the guy because he tells you, oh, I'm gay. You know, you don't even know what he means when he says that. So let's go canoeing. You know, we're going to the movies. Why don't you come with us? Include people, because if we don't include them, where are they going to go? They're going to go to people who say it's great, everything about it's great, and some of those people are going to be predatory. Not all of them, but some of them are. They're going to be vulnerable. Okay, these people are vulnerable. I know that there's something called the apostolate of friendship. Did I spell that right? The apostolate of friendship. That's something Saint Jose Maria talks about. Is the apostolate of friendship, and I think in this area, it's extremely important that we don't leave these kids isolated and on their own. So those are the references, and I'm going to stop talking now. Thank you.
Just been listening to Dr. J speaking from The Challenges of the Family Today, the 9th annual Asociación LAR Mexico conference held in Monterrey, Mexico. This was her third talk on the gender ideology. Tune into our podcast stream for the other two. LAR, which means home in Spanish, is part of the larger IFFD, the International Federation for Family Development. The Ruth Institute is a nonprofit educational organization equipping effective advocates for family stability and love, both at home and in the public square. Our podcasts can be found online at ruthinstitute.org and iTunes. And as always, they're under a Creative Commons license. If you've enjoyed them, please share them with friends. Like us on Facebook, check out the site, and subscribe to our weekly newsletter to stay informed.